go, whiteboarding, the last video of the ultimate interview series, a video that many people are expecting, the last video of 2022. So much pressure for me these days. In this video, I'm going to answer three main questions to catch you up to speed of what whiteboarding is and how to do it. I will start by breaking down what a whiteboarding session is so you know it's nothing special or scary. Then I will tell you what companies have given me a whiteboarding session and what they have asked me. In the end, I will show you very specific and actionable ways to approach whiteboarding by using some of the ones that I did as an example. If all those sound interesting and exciting for you, grab your favorite drink and let's get into it, y'all. Good morning, everyone. My name is Justine. I'm a designer working in Silicon Valley. Let's talk about, this. What is a whiteboarding session? I would say it's like a design exercise, but more high level. It's not aiming for the perfect visual, because you're going to do it on a whiteboard. For a take-home design exercise, you expect it to send something back like this. For whiteboarding, you will end up doing something like this. It's not going to be beautiful, but it will be sufficient, because they are assessing you different things. They will assess you on your ability to solve a problem as a designer and your ability to collaborate with hiring managers, with interviewers. That's why I will consider whiteboarding is the same as a collaborative problem-solving session on a whiteboard. Therefore, there are actually three things that you're doing here. To solve the problem, that means you should understand what the problem is, what the root cause of the problem, if it's not clear, is there any direct control of the root problem that you might have, who are the users, what are the constraints, that you should be able to brainstorm 3 to 5 ideas and validate those ideas, and etc. Then to collaborate, that means you need to ask interviewers questions because you're not doing this alone. You're not doing this by yourself. You're working with them. This session is meant to simulate the environment that you and them are working together so that they will see what they can expect from you if you join the team, which also means feel free to ask questions. You have the floor. You have the power. You're in a position that you can let your design thinking and skills lead and drive. The prompt is also likely to be vague and to design in ambiguity. Asking questions is the way to go. So make sure to ask them, who are the users? How do they behave? What do we know about them? What are the constraints? What do you think about this idea? What data in the past that shows that something else will work? What do you think? How are we doing on time? You might start to see it's very similar to the set of questions that you need to ask in order to solve the problem. See? It's connected. And then third, to do those two things on the whiteboard, you're expecting to visualize your thoughts and work on the whiteboard so that you and the interviewers can look at the same notes and point to the same idea when you're working together. That means you should be able to write things down. You should be able to take notes, 1, 2, 3. You should be able to draw wireframes and then draw arrows around them to connect them, what the flow is like. You should be able to cross stuff out, etc, etc, etc. If you can do all those three things well, you are in a pretty good shape. And good news, they are not particularly hard to do. You could have gained very similar experiences in school, in a group project, or even just practice on your own. Just as a quick FYI, some company will have an interview round called problem solving. This might mean only talking through it in a video call without really drawing anything on a piece of paper or whiteboard. I call this a verbal whiteboarding. It might also mean a real whiteboarding that you need to draw stuff out in person or in fake jam type of thing. So just be aware. If they call it whiteboarding session, it's likely a real one that you will draw stuff out and they want to assess those three things. I have had both in the past, so something you should know about. Speaking of what I've had, that's a great segue to the next part. Which companies have I done whiteboarding with and what did they ask me? For my 2017 Google internship, there's a question about designing a digital interface for an ATM machine, but it's not a touchscreen. How would you go about it? At Niantic in 2019, it's a verbal whiteboarding about 20-ish minutes. Design a mobile app that controls a toy helicopter. For Samsara in 2019, which is an enterprise software company, the question is to design a UI that you can switch accounts between parents and children. How would you go about it? With Chime in 2019, It was about designing a ride-hailing service that is free. How would it make money, and how would it be different from Uber and Lyft right now? For Fitbit in 2019, it was to design a smart home monitoring system for all the lights in the house. For DoorDash in 2019, I first had a verbal whiteboarding for about 20 minutes. It was about designing the next iteration of Pinterest Lens, which is something that I've worked on when I was at Pinterest. And then in the on-site interview, I did a full 45-minute round of whiteboarding. The prompt is something like, design a premium feature that drives users to order from a $3 restaurant at least once a month on Uber Eats. For Snap in 2022, it was about 15 to 20 minutes verbal whiteboarding. What would you consider when you design permission sharing of an app for a Wi-Fi router? So those are the ones that I've done. And next, we're going to go into how to approach whiteboarding. One way I would do it is to use the design process framework, the one that you're all familiar with, research, idea, prototype, test, production, to do it step by step. So let's use the DoorDash one as an example and see how we can approach it. Design a premium feature that drives users to order from a $3 restaurant at least once a month on Uber Eats. First, in the research phase, ask questions. Ask a lot of questions to seek clarity, because the prompt is so vague, so broad, so ambiguous. That's exactly the same thing that you should do to be collaborative. Ask questions. So who are the users to address this prompt? Are we aiming a particular segment of population? Are we aiming for users that have higher dispensable income because it's a $3 restaurant, right? Or this is meant to be for everybody on the platform? Do we want to make new users to order those? Or do we want users who order frequently to try out those $3 restaurants on Uber Eats? And then what is the problem? Is there already a feature for it that is not working? And what is the root problem? What is the root cost of the problem? People don't see those restaurants, they don't feel like they're interested in. Any data to back this up? Do people visit those restaurant pages? How about those who have ordered anything from those $3 restaurants? Did they come back? Did they not? Why? Why not? What are some of the constraints? Is it because there are too few $3 restaurants? Or because they're too expensive? Or people expect the quality to be amazing, but it's just okay? Is the delivery time always be too long to be worth it for a $3 restaurant? What are the constraints? You can also write them down to help you keep track and also help your interviewers to see and refer and reference the same thing during discussion. When you get the real prompt, you should feel it to get an idea of what else to ask. And there are two practical tips that I have about how to feel it. One is to really imagine you're a designer at a company and you are put on this project. You are leading the project. What do you want to know to help you design better, to help you move forward in the design process? Number two, imagine you are the user of this product. How do you want to use it? What feels good? What feels right to you? If you are using this premium feature, what helps you as a user to decide that you would want to order that? Do you want to see more appealing images? Or would those appealing images drive you to those 3-star restaurants? Or if you have ordered from those $3 restaurants before on Uber Eats, is it because the images are really appealing, or the price looks reasonable, or the portion is good, or the review is great? What drives you to order? What do you want to see to order? What are some of the questions you want to get answers from when you try to order from a $3 restaurant on Uber Eats? And then there should be more questions that you want to ask naturally. Then you go to the idea phase, brainstorm a few interaction design solutions. Remember, interaction design only. There's no need to think about font, color, spacing, transition, animation, just interaction design. The flow, how would the product flow? Think about existing patterns, simple stuff like a carousel, is it a page, is it a card format? Nothing complicated. You don't have to think about a groundbreaking, innovative concept, interaction design within like a 10-minute window. Literally, you draw a frame in a wire shape, and then you have a button, you do this, an arrow, that's a wireframe, that is sufficient. But just talk through it to the interviewers. This is a button that does this, so it takes you to this screen with a card layout screen with reviews, 3 stars, 2 stars, there, right? That's it. In the prototype and testing phase, likely you will ask them questions on what do you think? What are some potential user feedback for those wireframe ideas you just laid out on the whiteboard? Then you just have to iterate on it. If what you have doesn't work, doesn't address the requirement, the need, the problem, think of an alternative solution. If it helps you, it's actually okay to draw out this whole design process to set a high-level framework for you and also your interviewers to stay on course. And if you like a copy of this whiteboarding framework design process worksheet, feel free to leave a comment down below and then send me an email and I will respond back to you within 24 hours. And lastly, I would like to share with you some of my observations in the whiteboarding. What are some of the patterns? It appears to me that all the prompts is similar to the product that company would do or a project that the role that they will hire you for. So for example, if you know you will have a whiteboarding session interview round with Starbucks to practice, you can guess a few prompts that relates to their mobile app, their inventory management systems, or an interface that the barista will use to put in orders and complete transactions. Second, a prompt that they have that they give you is likely to be broad and ambiguous. And that is very, very intentional. So don't be afraid asking questions. You are expected to ask a lot of questions. And if you don't, you will likely fail. So does all of the above help? If you learn anything new or if you find anything helpful, smash like button down below to help support this channel, and I greatly appreciate it. Another good way to practice whiteboarding is in fact doing some app critiques yourself, because it stays at high level, similar to whiteboarding. It makes you talk through what you think, what you see, which is similar to things that you would do in whiteboarding. It gets you familiar with the interaction pattern, which is all you need to focus on in whiteboarding. And it makes you focus on analyzing the problem that a product is trying to solve. So you can prepare app critique and whiteboarding at the same time. One bird, two stones. Brilliant. And I've used my best design thinking and craft to capture those in these videos for you. Check them out right there. Like and subscribe to help support this channel. Keep designing a better future. See you on the next video. Cheers.